getting stronger is not just about moving the most weight from point A to point B. The way you are lifting the weight actually has a profound influence on what you're building. If I'm lifting a weight very slowly on purpose, focusing on maximum contraction, or if I'm lifting with as much speed as possible, even though in both cases I might be using the same weight, it will not have the same training effect. Mm-hmm. Now, powerlifters, bodybuilders, they often focus on lifting heavy weights, like pushing very heavy weights, not super fast, of course. Or they do mind-muscle connection or technique work where they go slower on purpose, maximizing tension and position. Pause lifting would fall also in that category. But not enough of them uses what we call compensatory acceleration training. Basically, you compensate a small weight by an increase in acceleration. Mm-hmm. Force equals mass times acceleration. So even if I'm moving a small weight, 50, 60, 70%, or even 80% if you are naturally explosive, but you're moving it with maximum speed, you can be producing just as much force as if you're lifting mm-hmm. a heavier weight. So is compensatory acceleration training something that you use in your own training?
Yes, a lot. I use it a lot. And not only that, I mean, compensatory acceleration training, you actually get past your sticking point. Mm. You develop so much speed out of the bottom of the movement that you get past the sticking point because of the speed because of the acceleration that you're creating in the movement.
It was, I think, Boris Shako said that the more speed you can produce at the beginning of the lift, the higher the sticking point will be. And the higher it is, the easier it is to overcome it because you are in a better position in your strength.
Closer lockout. Yeah. And this is actually a principle that Fred Hatfield. Rest in peace. Mm-hmm. Fred Hatfield developed over the years, which is now used in many different
People think it's Westside came up with the speed work. Hatfield came up with
before. Well, Westside revolutionized the accommodating resistance, using bands and chains to get that speed work. Mm-hmm. But Fred Hatfield said, just use less weight on the bar mm-hmm. and move the bar as fast as possible, create as much power and explosion in the movement so that you do get past that sticking point. And he squatted 1,014 pounds.
That's
and he was 45 years old. Yeah. Yes, which is amazing.
Yeah, it was 242 pounds.
That's insane. Yeah,
actually, it's funny because Fred was actually one of my first influences in training. I actually wrote for his website back then.
Yeah,
I was a big member of his Dr. Squat forum about at least 20 years ago. Man, mm. I mean, my first three influences. It's funny because it was Fred Hatfield, Charles Poliquin, and Charles Staley. I mean, Staley and Fred worked together with the International Sports Science Association. Mm-hmm. They basically founded the ISSA, which is a pretty good certification program to this day. Now, one thing I think also that, the one point you mentioned that I really like was the blasting to your sticking point thing. The image I like to use is that a sticking point is just like a brick that the karate guy is trying to break. I mean, if you push like very slowly and try to push as hard as possible against the brick, you won't break it. Mm-hmm. If you want to break that brick, you must come up with speed. So the more speed you can produce, the easier it's going to be to break that sticking point. But I think that very few people take advantage of it.
And one of the images that I remember hearing is, you know, we say sticking point. Mm. Sticking point, what is a sticking point? A sticking point is imagining trying to get an object to slide through like a smudge of glue. Mm. The slower you slide that object through the smudge, the more it's going to stick to the glue, right? The faster you slide it through, the less likely it is to stop moving. So sticking point, fast movement, explosive.
So we're basically talking about the weights of how much percent, like 60, 70?
Even 50. Even 50%.
So I would guess it depends on the person's natural capacity to accelerate. I mean, I've known people who are super explosive naturally. These people can probably get by 80% on CAT because they can be very explosive with 80%. So you would use more bar speed than the actual weight because for some people, even with 60%, it doesn't move fast.
Yes.
So you must use a weight that you can move with speed.
Also, very important to say, if you want to use CAT training, compensatory acceleration training, you need to be very efficient at the movement.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of times you'll see people trying to move the bar very fast, let's say on the bench press, and their shoulders get off the bench, they lose all leg drive. it's really important to master the lift and the technique of the lift before trying to apply speed. And it's like saying somebody that doesn't have an efficient movement putting 95% of an 1RM on the bar. You know, if you put too much load on the bar, then the technique is gonna be thrown out the window. It's the same thing with speed training. You should look at speed training the same way you look at max effort training.
In a sense, it is a max effort because the force production is maximum because of the acceleration.
Yes, it's just less taxing and easier to recover from, but absolutely.
So you do need basically to have the exact same technique when doing a like CAT set than a very heavy set.
Yeah, and actually, I've actually heard Mark Bell say this on one of the podcasts recently. Actually, Matt Wenning was on his podcast. It's actually a really great episode. If you guys want to hear the Matt Wenning on the Powercast lately, there's two parts, part one and two. And he talks about, Mark Bell that is, he talks about sometimes some of his trainees don't know how to keep proper form under CAT training. So he'll actually load heavier weight on the bar so they can get more of a feel to keep the shoulders back and get everything tensed up. And then he tells them to move the bar fast. Mm. So it depends who you're dealing with. Sometimes, so people that are naturally explosive, then yes, you should put a little bit more on the bar. But people that can't keep proper technique under too light of a load, sometimes putting a little bit more can be efficient as well.
I think it might be psychological. I mean,
even
if you're trying hard not to, I mean, if you only have like 185 pounds on the bar, well, you're gonna take it lightly because if it's like it's 50% of your maximum, even though you're trying to psych yourself up to stay tight, be aggressive, mentally it's kind of hard to do. So sometimes having more weight might be useful. The one cue I like to give, at least on the bench press, is instead of trying, because if the person is trying to push the barbell as fast as possible, then the shoulders will come up. So I tell them, just try to push yourself down into the bench as hard as you can. Basically trying to slam your back into the bar. So that's gonna have the same kind of effect and it's gonna be better to maintain technique.
And it's really important to focus on, like CAT training, it's not just trying to move the bar a little fast. You want to be as explosive as possible with the bar.
It's violent. It's
violent. Yeah. It's aggressive. You really got to power
through. The same mindset as if you're trying to punch somebody.
Exactly.
Yeah. So how much volume are we talking about? I mean, can you do more sets? Since it's a max effort, will you keep the same number of sets? How you do?
I actually keep the volume pretty low in terms of sets and in terms of reps as well, because you want to use the dynamic effort as a simulation for the max effort. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to do speed work for 12 reps. Mm-hmm. That will be more for the rep day if you got a rep day in your template. But you want to simulate the max effort day with lighter weight on the bar. So three sets of three maybe. I wouldn't go more than that.
I do think that from experience, and I've used like a unit that measures bar speed.
Yeah.
And I think that most people when they do like 5, 6, 8 sets of speed work, bar speed goes down. Mm-hmm. And you don't even notice it.
No, you don't notice it.
If you don't measure it, you don't notice it. And you just take bad motor habit because of that. Yeah. I think that the focus should always be on quality more so than quantity.
Absolutely, I agree.
Excellent.